statements. Thank you all for joining us. Anyone have any announcements, any joys or concerns?
Glad we're all here today.
Glad we're all here. Okay, nothing else, and we will begin our worship.
Mercy, mercy.
May we evoke your humble heart within us. May we wonder what it might mean to feel our exhaustion and your love at the exact same time. May we consider all you tried to show, give, or say to us that we weren't yet ready for. Prepare our souls to yoke with yours, to share the good news that revives every living thing. We ask this in your name and energy.
Amen.
Spirit of God, you are always among us, and yet at times we don't notice or get caught up in our judgments, not recognizing you in the stranger on the street or the stranger in me, who does not do the things I want, but rather the things I hate. Perhaps we thought our certainty would keep us safe or ignorance would keep us pain-free, but you show us the way of trust and awareness is what paves the path of peace. Forgive and help us, O God, by the power, grace, and connection.
Amen.
No matter the weight of our burdens or the age of our weariness, let us come before our rest-giving God. Rest for our shame and unbelief. Rest for our bootstraps, egos, and false idols. Rest to open up to grace that says, I feel so much better since I laid my burdens down. Rest for the receptivity to our yes. Yes to forgiveness, yes to repair, and yes to being fearfully and wonderfully made.
Amen.
Let us praise God. Then Rebecca and her maids rose up, mounted the camels, and followed the man. Thus the servant took Rebekah and went his way. Now Isaac had come from Beer El Haroi and was settled in the Negev. Isaac went out in the evening to walk in the field, and looking up, he saw camels coming. And Rebekah looked up, and she saw Isaac. She slipped quickly from the camel and said to the servant, "Who is the man over there walking in the field to meet us?" The servant said, "It is my master." So she took her veil and covered herself. And the servants told Isaac all the things that he had done. Then Isaac brought her into her mother Sarah's tent. He took Rebekah, and she became his wife, and he loved her. So Isaac was comforted after his mother's death. Our second reading comes from the 7th chapter of Romans. I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. Now if I do what I do not want, I agree that the law is good. But in fact, it is no longer that I do it, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that nothing good dwells within me, that is, in my flesh. I can will what is right, but I cannot do it. For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I do. Now, if I do what I do not want, it is no longer that I do it, but sin that dwells within me. So I find it to be a law that when I want to do what is good, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law of God in my inmost self. But I see in my members another law at war within the law of my mind, making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will rescue me from this body of death? Thanks be to God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then, with my mind, I am a slave to the law of God, but with my flesh, I am a slave to the law of sin. And our gospel lesson comes from the 11th chapter of Matthew. But to what will I compare this generation? It is like children sitting in the marketplaces and calling to one another. We played the flute for you, and you did not dance. We wailed, and you did not mourn. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say, he has a demon. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, look, a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners, yet wisdom is vindicated by her deeds. At that time Jesus said, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent and have revealed them to infants. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light.
Thank you. sitting in the marketplaces and calling to one another. Jesus' words, as he addresses a crowd made up both of willing followers and skeptical accusers, ring of frustration and puzzlement. Is he lashing out in anger? Is he throwing up his hands in disgust? We're not really accustomed to hearing Jesus sound like this. That is, wandering into the risky waters of cross-generational criticism. In fact, he sounds here more like us. But to what will I compare this generation? They spend too much time buried in their smartphones. Or, okay, boomer, you are so out of touch and old-fashioned. The world is changing. You better catch up. But what will I compare this generation to? Have you seen the clothes they wear? Sloppy and ugly and too revealing. Or, why can't you old people understand self-expression? My clothes help me be my authentic self in this world. But to what will I compare this generation? That new worship music they're using is so monotonous and repetitive and lacking depth. Or, those old hymns are boring, hard to sing, and old-fashioned. Choose your topic these days, sacred or secular, and it seems like so many opinions of what's right and what's good fall right along generational lines. Heads are shaken in exasperation and, if you're like me, standing in line recently for a cell phone upgrade that will drag me kicking and screaming into a new generation, beads of anxious sweat form along the ridge of the brow. We know that new is not necessarily improved, and traditional may not always mean wiser. But the debates rage on, and from this morning's gospel lesson, we see that Jesus is no stranger either to the friction that occurs when generations of human beings set their habits and expectations up against one another. In this case, Jesus is frustrated and almost irritated that the people of his day and age are so unreceptive to the message he and his disciples are preaching, which is at odds with the message they've heard for so long from the Pharisees' sermons and the scribes' teachings. And it's not just his message they've questioned and rejected, it's also his cousin John's. The crowds can't seem to get their heads around the God who is presented in each of their respective messages. The generations of their day can't fathom the kingdom of heaven as it is proclaimed from the lips of these two newcomers. And who can blame them? Both of these yokels hail from off-the-beaten-track Galilean towns far from the traditional academy of Jerusalem. Neither has a formal synagogue training that we know of. One sequesters himself in the desert half the time, eating wild honey and locusts, coming close to civilization from time to time, just long enough to dunk people in the Jordan River and publicly criticize the ruler's morals. The other one, Jesus, hangs out with a bunch of tax collectors and other lowlifes, frequenting banquets and parties. Both seem to go against the status quo quite a bit, positioning themselves a number of times as the preferred option to the way things are. But John is too much of an extremist, and Jesus seems too lax. John is a little too fanatical. Jesus, not fanatical enough. Who would take these guys seriously, especially about matters that the Pharisees do such a good job of explaining, convoluted though they may be? This is the situation in which both John and Jesus confront a populace of their own people who can't get their head around a new way of seeing God act and move in the world. To John, the people are hard-headed and ignorant. They need baptism for repentance and need it now, for the winnowing fork of God's justice is in his hand, and the chaff will be burned. We must assume that would be John's reaction to this, of course, for at this time, he is currently in prison awaiting what will be his execution for the crime of criticizing Herod's decision to marry his brother's wife. And Jesus, on the other hand, compares the generation to children in a marketplace who resort to gentle and pleading tactics in order to coax the people to dance or mourn for them. With inspiring words and uplifting promises of forgiveness, Jesus has played the flute, so to speak, to get the people to dance along with his vision of the kingdom of heaven. And the people still stand on the sidelines in their stubbornness. Likewise, he has cried the haunting mourner's wail, reminding them of their need for mercy, and yet the people remain unmoved. Have you ever tried to explain your faith to someone who perhaps doesn't believe? Have you ever tried to convince someone of the love of God or of your involvement in the life of a congregation to a person who, for whatever reason, is reluctant to follow along? To a large degree, Jesus' experience with people's doubt of and rejection of his message is common to people in each and every age. Whether we encounter difficulty in preaching the gospel of Jesus on a personal level, or whether we get frustrated when our congregations don't grow and gather new members, it seems as if the church will always have to live with some level of discomfort or frustration with how we are received by the generation at hand. Statistics indicate that the number of people in society who identify as having no religious affiliation is on the rise. Explaining what God is like and sharing our faith will likely get more challenging. Jesus' immediate response to his own discouragement is to offer thanksgiving that the gospel message is not something to be grasped by knowledge or wisdom or sophisticated reasoning. Faith, as the reformer Martin Luther would put it, is ultimately a gift of the Holy Spirit and cannot be conjured by our own strength or power. Indeed, Jesus' teachings are hidden from the intelligent and revealed to the young and inexperienced, the simple and the pure heart. How many of us find ourselves more captivated by a children's sermon, for example, than by the words preached from the pulpit or the screen? And by the same token, I know many pastors who, like I, are as intimidated by delivering a children's sermon as they are preaching a big people's sermon. A religious system that rightly asks its leaders to attend a seminary and receive a post-secondary degree can send the message that brains are what's required for a deeper faith, or to have faith at all. Pretty soon, we forget how the infants see things. Here is when Jesus reminds us once again that it's not brains that will lead to deeper faith, and it's not a sophisticated understanding about how the universe works that will ultimately cause one to come to Christ. It's not brains we need, burden. Our attraction to Jesus' kingdom comes from the desire for an easier burden than the ones we're carrying already, a longing for rest for our souls. St. Augustine, a man of supreme intelligence who did not convert to Christian faith until much later in life, once said, "I have read in Plato and Cicero things that are very wise and very beautiful, but I have never read in either of them, 'Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest.'" No, it's not wisdom or beauty, although they are there, that ultimately draws us to the way of Jesus, but rather the promise of an easier way. It's a hope that draws us. The hope that when we cast our sorrows on this whippersnapper from Galilee, we receive something far better than we ever imagined. It's an emerging confidence that this whippersnapper will go to the cross for us and exchange our path of death and guilt and shame for a new life filled with undying love and forgiveness. What draws us is not flashy knowledge and sophisticated arguments that compel us to come to Jesus, but rather the understanding that somehow, with His love and His community, our way in this world is indeed made easier, even though following Him may be dreadfully difficult at specific times. Thankfully, this was recently revealed to me again during a week-long youth retreat. Several dozen people of a generation younger than mine spent 6 days praying, worshiping, and studying Scripture together. Although spending long days away from my family, sleeping on a hard mattress in a barely air-conditioned residence hall is not how I'd ideally like to spend a week of the summer, I always return from these events renewed. Not because I've had the opportunity to teach and lead, but because the youth always manage to teach me something about trusting in Jesus. Some of them speak it quietly in the comfort of a small group, while others take the opportunity to address the whole large group with a reflection on their faith, like a testimony. Some of these youth speak of heart-wrenching personal hardship and experiences with grief or self-harm, while others confess a relatively strong faith bred in their home congregations. No matter the method, no matter the venue, one theme is evident in every testimony. These youth desire an easier yoke than the one they carry now in life. They long for a Lord who is gentle and humble of heart. They seek a rest and comfort in a world that simultaneously idolizes youth and also expects them to grow up too fast. And in their prayers and concerns, I detect a realization that coming to Christ is not purely an unloading and releasing of guilt and shame and heaviness of heart. I also hear an understanding that Jesus gives something in return. That is, He has a yoke also, one for us to wear with Him. He longs for us to change and grow and bear His word to the world. But I must tell you, it's not primarily at these types of retreats and gatherings that I am reminded of Jesus' promise of an easier yoke and lighter burden. That actually happens each and every Sunday, indeed, each and every day. When I speak on the phone or share a word with someone in the hospital, when someone I serve shares their own story of experiencing God's glory or their own prayer concerns for those they love, when they show up for worship in the middle of a hectic and busy lifestyle to anchor their week in the community of Christ's disciples. And it is people of all generations. I'm reminded of their deep faith when they arrive at the communion rail in my church, hands open, head maybe bowed or eyes lifted up in hopeful expectation, taking this guy from Nazareth seriously. Not too unlike the children who come up here earlier in the service for a time with the pastor of the children's sermon. I see them wanting what Christ will give, presenting their shoulders once again for the gracious yoke, handing over their heavy hearts in exchange for that easier burden, a burden that brings forgiveness, joy, relief. It is there in the bread and the wine where they are reminded that Jesus bore the ultimate burden to give them life. And then I see those people, once again, refreshed, empowered, head lifted higher, shouldering that lighter burden of the Spirit's transformation, making their way back to their seats in the pew, and then making their way back out the door, ready to bear this faith once again this week to any generation they happen to meet in the marketplace or the workplace or the home. It's a living faith, born on the lips of true infants and children, whether they're 1 or 101, reborn infants and children of God who know the love of the Father because, thanks be to God, he has revealed it to them. And today, once again, he reveals it to you. Amen.
Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for all the blessings which you have bestowed upon us. And now as we come to you, asking for assistance and guidance, let us open our hearts, let us put our faith and trust in you, knowing that you know better than we what is best for us. Continue to guide us and strengthen us. And now we have special prayers for Judy, Mark, Dottie, Dale, Joe and family, Morgan, Lois, Paul, Marlene, Jim, Chris, Shirley, Wayne, Pat, Tina, Jim, Carol, Louise, Joanne, Dan, Pat, Tricia, Claire, Naomi, Debbie, Kay, Amy, Patty, Tammy, Butch, David, John, Shirley, Judy, Lance, Rudy, Sue, Dizzy, Stephanie and family, Jean, Glenn, Marcia, Brianna, Rob, Blaze, Veronica, Sarah, Louise, Dan, Richard, family of George, to our church and congregation, for the people of the Ukraine. And now let us pray the prayer which you taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Thank you. risen Savior, He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever men may say. I see His hand of mercy, I hear His voice of cheer. And just the time I need Him, He's always dear. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart. In all the world around me, I see His love and care. And though my heart grows weary, I never will despair. I know that He is leading through all the stormy blast. The day of His appearing will come at last. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to
rejoice, rejoice, O Christian, lift up your voice and sing. Eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek Him, the help of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along.
O God of rejuvenation, may we leave this place feeling alive, awake, and made for this day. In You there is hope for satisfaction, while our hunger for justice remains everlasting. May we find strength in gentleness and relief to heavy loads, and may we carry Your promise of refuge with us wherever we go.
Amen.